Luke Kerner with Crypto Oracle, and thanks to everybody for coming here tonight and being part of this is really two communities tonight. This is Crypto Mondays, which we've been running since January every week, and this is also really the first security token meetup. We really think that the biggest difference between crypto and everything that came before it is community. And so we're doing everything we can to build communities where we think community should be grown. Crypto Monday is just a general, hey, anybody who wants to in the community, let's come and have crypto. This is, you know, the security token meetup is for people who, you know, think are really passionate and really believe that security tokens are going to be a massive new asset, you know, a massive new financial instrument. And you know, we're lucky tonight to have two, I think, really thoughtful guys who are coming at security tokens from different perspectives. And you know, I know both of them actually pretty well at this point, but I will let them introduce themselves. So we'll start with Vince.
Hey, and Lou, thanks so much. And I think it's awesome that you're bringing the community together, particularly in this great evolution of securities tokens. And thanks everybody for coming. I'm Vince Molinari. I'm co-founder of Templum. My partner, Chris Pallotta, who's CEO, is hiding out in the back there, so I have to call him out back there. We're a fintech blockchain holding company that operates at the intersection of the modernization of securities law and the most innovative technologies, and we seek to create new market infrastructure around the processes of security transactions. I'm the CEO of our subsidiary, Templum Markets. Templum Markets is a full broker-dealer that is approved in all states here in the U.S., three foreign territories, and four provinces in Canada for the primary issuance of digital assets and securities, a key point to differentiate between cryptocurrencies and securities, issuing those pursuant to Reg D, Reg S, and Reg A+. We are also an alternative trading system registered with the SEC and FINRA for the past 2 years. And we're actually approved to do secondary liquidity of ICOs and digital assets. We have a quotation bureau that allows us to publish real-time mark-to-market quotes on these instruments, as well as take indications of interest on a 24/7 basis. And lastly, achieved a qualified matching service designation from the U.S. Department of Treasury to transact in non-traded limited partnership interests.
So terrific. And does the pin anything there?
PIN is very important. So PIN is the Sustainable Development Goals of the UN, where we think blockchain smart contracts have a huge role in delivering good around the world, particularly when we talk about in this room, closing the gender gap of having very few women, or what was 3 to 5% of women engaged in blockchain. So we also launched something called Decade of Women. Come and find more about that. So really about utilizing all these wonderful new technologies that we have around blockchain smart contracts, not only for finance generally, but to deliver capital for good.
Okay, and Tim, what are you doing to make the world a better place?
That's a good one. I am familiar with the Sustainable Development Goals, and was almost going to work for the Rockefeller Foundation, where they're working on using innovative finance, including blockchain technology, to actually try to, you know, fix the funding gap between what governments have actually promised, you know, which is roughly around, you know, $30 billion, and the $100 billion that's actually needed to achieve those minimal levels. So you know, some exposure, and to actually think that blockchain is one of those potential capital market solutions to handle that issue, and particularly as an acute meaning to the underbanked in places like South America and Africa. Back a little bit more about myself. My name is Timothy Fury. I've spent probably around 13 to 14 years in investment banking, capital markets, ranging everywhere from the Federal Reserve Board of Governors in D.C. up through investment banking on the street, Bear Stearns, UBS, Oppenheimer, and some other shops. And involved in everything from kind of like traditional financial capital raises, would be called on the street FIG, and also, you know, up through more of the exotic private placements and emerging markets. And I think this was something that, you know, as, you know, I saw the need for, you know, fundamental changes in the industry, but also it was that kind of ability to take risk and try new things that I think myself and a lot of the other entrepreneurs in the space are, you know, is a common trait that's actually helping us kind of roll out this space. So Sabbath Group itself, I've been there pretty much since it was founded in December of last year. The team there was actually probably the oldest team. We originally had another shop and then founded SAS in December. And we were actually responsible for doing the first security tokens, BCAT. We also did Proto Science, which they were not only the first security tokens, but also the first fund tokens. So we've been involved in the space for quite a while. Our founder and CEO, Emma Channing, is one of the most well-respected within the space from a legal structuring point of view, and she saw very early on, given her extensive experience with it, at SCAD and other top law firms, that really was going to be a progression towards security tokens as the SEC started clamping down, and along with other regulators. So we've been kind of all in on this space since the very beginning. So we think this is a very exciting times, and I've read a lot of Lou's work, and I know he's been very big on the this instrument class for a while now.
Yeah, no, it's exciting times. And just before we start the panel, you were talking about great legal minds. I also wanted to thank our hosts tonight, Ed Reed Smith, Kari Larson. Thank you very much. I don't know if Herb is still around. Thanks for hosting us tonight. And Emma Channing is no longer in private practice, but Kari is. So. let's start, because I'm really interested. I've actually known Vince for 5 or 6 years. I actually was an advisor.
Probably longer than that.
At one of his previous companies, Gate Technologies, and so I know Vince has been there. At the forefront as a pioneer in the trading and exchanges of alternative assets, crowdfunding, and so. Can you, with all that perspective, give us a little context on how you see where we are now, and in the context of time, kind of where we are in terms of security tokens really being a big thing?
Yeah, and there's lots to unbundle there, and I'll try to do it real quickly. But since we've been through a few cycles, as Lou would say, in the marketplace, we look at digital assets or security tokens much more as an evolution versus perhaps where cryptocurrencies are a bit more of a revolution. So if we start from the premise that if we look at recorded ownership, and Donna and I talked back to the buttonwood tree and curbside trading, but if we start from share certificates, right? Most people forgot that we held recorded ownership in paper format. And as volumes increased over time, the exchanges had more difficulty in processing that paper. People forget that. This thing called a cage, right? Where you have to come and reconcile paper certificates. The American Stock Exchange closed on Wednesday so they can catch up with the trading volumes. So as more retail engagement got involved, more trading, and paper couldn't be processed until we had this little thing called the paper crisis of the 1970s. Wow, guess what happened? We almost had a meltdown of our financial service system. Innovation came to be. What did we do? We had registrars, transfer agents, and recorded ownership was held electronically, right? A great evolution. Well, now as things moved on, we truly believe that the smart contract is now the next evolution of recorded ownership. But what does that do? Creates beautiful efficiency to have transparency, a mutable narrative, audit trails. You can have hashing back to last pricing. You can have hashing back to last offering documents, public releases. So there's continuity of information across the spectrum for all investors. That lends itself to beautiful levels of taking these smart contracts, as we did back to 2015, and petitioned the SEC to amend Regulation ATS, again, modernization of securities law, so that we can have it for unregistered securities. So now it puts us in a position to have a transparent ATS, unlike our dark pools back in the day, where you can have full bids, offers, depths of markets, and create a holistic marketplace that we believe truly engages all participants. And really going back to lots of time that Lou and I spent back on the Jobs Act day, right? This is all about the increased issuance of unregistered securities insurances. Last year, $2.4 trillion of unregistered securities issued in the United States. Let's put that in perspective. Public markets probably did about $1.6 trillion. A lot of them have to do with the Jobs Act, the changes of 12G, going from 500 shareholders to 2,000, the ability to generally solicit or advertise for the first time in U.S. history after the Jobs Act. So if we can take all that beautiful momentum and have the efficiencies now with blockchain and smart contract, we think we're on a paradigm shift that's going to change the face of finance for the next 10, 20, 30 years or greater.
And Tim, obviously, you're looking at this from a very different perch. You know, you spend time in utility tokens as well as in security tokens. My guess is, Vince, you haven't spent 2 seconds thinking about utility tokens. And so, you know, how do you put kind of where we are into context in the arc of time that you've been around and thinking about this?
Sure, I'm glad you mentioned that, because I think maybe taking, I agree with everything Vince said, and I think maybe taking one step back into kind of what is a security token. And a security token, that, I mean, it can take a lot of different forms. Even the instrument itself is still evolving, but at a very kind of granular level, and let's look at this only within the U.S. context, right? It's a token that under SEC guidelines is considered a security, meaning it's under the Howey test. It's something, not to get into the whole legal jargon of all this stuff, but where you have, you know, something that goes into a payment of funds, that go into a common enterprise that you're not part of, that where there's an expectation of gain, whether it's dividends, interest, you know, secondary appreciation, secondary market appreciation, all of these kind of things. So now what that is, will these instruments have the, like, utility pieces where they work within a network? Some say they will, some say they won't, but some of them will just actually represent the underlying, let's say, value of a company as it increases, right? Just in the way that a share or other bond would. So I think within the market itself, and maybe this goes into another question, we're at the stage where, you know, the SEC started moving in. They've basically said that a lot of the tokens that have already been issued, a lot of these ICOs, they see through their eyes as failing this Howey test. They've not really said what they're going to actually do for the most part about it. They really haven't gone in from an enforcement standpoint to do much more than just, let's say, fraud levels, where, you know, you have people that have raised money, have been shown to be fraudulent. But the real issue, and I guess we can talk about this a little later, is the build out of the infrastructure with regards to, let's say, custody solutions, secondary exchanges, and things like that. So I think we're really at those early stages where a lot of this will really be built out come the end of this year and into early next year.
Yeah, and obviously you brought up a lot of things of interest there. You know, let's, you know, the kind of, obviously the kind of elephant in the room is, what, you know, how do you think about the regulatory environment and how you operate your business?
And I think it's a great jumping off point, and I love that Satis has made that evolution or that transition, and Zemba's been one of the bigger leaders, if you would, on utility tokens. So I think the realization that utility tokens maybe were misunderstood early on, right? And the recognition that this is a securities practice, going back to March 2017, we wrote a petition to the SEC that defined our position, that said these instruments, utility tokens, rather look a lot like a digital security. And if so, they should be treated as such. And if we do that and they fail the Howey test, we have a wonderful existing rule book to follow. We didn't have to reinvent the wheel. You had the 33 and 34 Act, my goodness, right? You had the Jobs Act. So now we can issue under Reg D, Reg S, Reg A+, and you have AML, right? Important hallmarks of confidence and integrity of our system, right? Suitability requirements, know your customer. So once you do that, it's the first transition of being able to have institutional participants, family offices, fund managers, and accredited investors have a similar viewpoint of what's comfortable. So they understand the instrument, and when you transition to there, so we purely think, or clearly think, most of these instruments are securities. Is there a place for utility tokens? Absolutely. If you utilize them properly as on a closed app, machine-to-machine, other fan base, when you take them off that app, they become something else. If you want to sell them, maybe they have much more of a commodity. So our view is, as we transition here, this is a huge opportunity as a securities practice. What we're missing in our public markets, and again, we've had these conversations many times, Luke, you know, going from 500 IPOs a year down to 110, and maybe we sit at 120, 130, and those IPOs are in the billions, that exit strategy or pathway to liquidity is uncertain. When you can take a Reg D offering and have a pathway that's 12 months certain and potential liquidity, or a Reg A plus that's almost instantaneous, we think that's a great facilitator for job creation, economic expansion that our country needs to continue to facilitate our entrepreneurship.
And Tim, when you think about the security token opportunity that's in front of you, are there particular areas where you're focused on in terms of, you know, what's going to be tokenized first and what the types of companies you want to work with?
Well, Let me just kind of go off what Vince said, and then I'll go into that. And one of the problems that we're finding is, as Vince mentioned, the these laws that go back, back to the 1930s, where a lot of this is based off of, and we're hoping that Congress will act to, make a lot of changes that now, bring them up to date to where the financial system is and is going. But we've had clients that have want to come in and actually issue security tokens, but because of the way that the kind of the very boxed in nature that the current legal framework provide, they've said, listen, fundamentally these tokens cannot be used in the underlying business case that's going on. So they actually switch back to utility, because even though they wanted to be fully compliant, had the right lawyers, had run these things in the past, every box checked in family members, former SEC, they couldn't actually get around to making it work given the restrictions. Like, let's say some of the, not the inability to trade for 12 months or some of these other things. So there's fundamentally even problems with the structure for those that even want to do the right thing and issue securities. And to the question that that Lou asked, I think this is because this is so new. We only do security tokens at this point. And there's a lot of different clients that are coming forward to us. Real estate, we got guys that want to do, hedge fund of funds that cater to existing, hedge funds that don't invest in crypto but regular assets, but want to go out there and actually have kind of permanent capital. And so there's all these different varieties out there. And the ones that we look at are the ones that, where you have real teams involved in real businesses that have name recognition. Some of these guys that we're talking to have, former congressmen or senators on their board, because the first guys that come to market are really gonna be, the bellwethers going forward. And so we wanna see the best ones out there because if we realize if we get some prominent real estate transactions that work, that convince the buy side that it's now time to jump in the pool, the space will just explode. And so you're probably not going to see anywhere near the returns you did with the utility markets of 10x, 20x, 30x. You shouldn't, but you'll see the volume of AUM, assets under management, rushing into the space, eclipsing it by leaps and bounds.
And so the getting back to, so when you talk about looking for the kind of premier transactions, what kind of things are you looking for?
I think a lot of the things we're looking at is the things that you look at in, there's two types with the security tokens. There's the ones that are actually kind of blockchain enabled companies, right? So this is a company that is genuinely using blockchain and for whatever the purpose may be, that's, let's say, issuing a token that has an equity-like component to it, where as that business grows, as it succeeds, the people actually get to enjoy that benefit as well, just like a normal shareholder would, and sometimes they actually have a component of it that may be used within the network. Then the other side of this is, which I think Lou is referring to, is the actual digitalization of kind of previous assets, where you can get, let's say, parts of the commercial real estate stack that are now tokenized and can then be freely traded all over the world, and where whoever owns it gets that equivalent interest that belongs to that piece. So I think the real issue and the challenge that we're finding is, and this is some of it relates to the infrastructure, namely, let's say the custodianship is one, of when those institutional buyers are going to be convinced that their fiduciary duty has been met and they can get involved in this market. And I think when you see, let's say, some sovereign funds or some other, I think the pension funds will wind up being later in the list, but some of these big institutional guys getting in, Wall Street's, they don't want to be the first person out to stick their head up. But once that gets moving, I think you'll see a lot of people jump in the pool.
I assume you've got a few thoughts on that?
Yeah, so I think keeping with the pool analogy, so I think we've gone from murky waters to a pretty good pool, and now we're putting in the lanes. So I think at Templeton we've done a really commendable job, proud of the team, both on the primary issuance and the secondary trading. At the end of the day, we believe a hallmark to investor protection is access to liquidity. And what I think we're finding as an exchange-like mechanism to collaborate with other participants who may be on the issuance side, you need that destination for liquidity. And that destination, secondary liquidity, drives the front end likelihood of people wanting to come and engage, because we always ask ourselves before we invest, what's our exit strategy? I think where we're focused quite strongly now is the back-end infrastructure. So, as alluded to here, right? So it's the transfer agency function. It is the self-clearing. It is the custody. And now that Templum is engaged in those areas, both buy, build, and partner, it's building that new market infrastructure so that the institutional flows can feel comfortable coming into the space. So I think that's really essential. I think there's a couple of core portions. Certainly real estate, everybody's excited about real estate. What does it represent? And I broadly say it's an illiquid instrument. And I think when you look at real estate or liquid instruments, they trade at a discount because of the liquidity, whether it's 10, 20, or 30%. So I firmly believe part of the delta here is when you're converting to a digital format and you can access liquidity, you're going to see compression of that illiquid discount. If it was 20, it may be going to 5 or 10%. And I think when you really talk about marquee assets, particularly in real estate, you're probably going to see those trade to a premium, because the other side of this access to liquidity is investors accessing investments that they didn't typically have access to, you know, opening up or the democratization of capital formation. So I think you're going to see a number of flows of capital changing the very valuation matrix of how we look at illiquid instruments.
And what do you guys think in terms of, Tim, I'll let you start, in terms of the timing? When are those rails going to be there that are going to enable this to really kind of hit that, velocity, escape velocity?
Gotcha. I mean, companies like Templum and others are basically in an arms race to be the first out there, to be the best products out there. There's everything going on from the secondary trading platforms. You have everything from obviously Templum, T0, OFN, a lot of other platforms that are really trying to get, you know, all the licensing issues taken care of, all the tech taken care of, and trying to, you know, get issuers on that platform and create that liquidity. So not only from the issuer side, but also the buy side as well. So we're seeing that, and the same thing goes with the custody issues as well. We see it kind of near the end of this year. A lot of those issues, a lot of solutions will start really in earnest coming to market. And I think come 2019, you'll really see a lot of this space take off.
I think it started in 2015 when we wrote up first petition for rule change. And I think we've done 17 comment letters petition for rule change to the SEC and FINRA in the last 30 months. So. I think the front end, I think, look, the space is so big, there's plenty for everybody to make money and earn. So I think we're going to see lots of collaboration going back to syndicates and selling groups of issuing platforms that we've had historically. To the arms race analogy, yeah, kind of. I think it's a bit of a race, but I'd say all alternative trading systems aren't created equal, and there's 87 ATSs in the United States, all designed for exchange-to-exchange public market execution. Is about 6 or 7 that have some level of unregistered securities issuances. To our knowledge, Templum was the first and perhaps still the only one that has their ATS amended to reflect approvals from the SEC for digital assets and ICOs. So we're running hard and fast, but I think it's that back end that we started now with our own transfer agent and self-clearing. You know, you get into the challenge, and Lou knows this as well. How do you get an approval for a self-clearing firm when you don't have a DTCC number? Well, guess what? These instruments don't trade or settle DTCC. So go round and round with the regulators to try to come to an outcome of, hey, let's set the standard, because it's about best practice standardization so that we can continue to collaborate. Both existing financial service folks, people entering, and it's really the crypto community collaborating with the regulatory framework now and really build this to what it really can be, and it's just a massive opportunity.
Yeah, and in terms of thinking of what it can be, you know, we've spent a lot of time obviously here just now, talking about, you know, the ability to raise money globally is awesome, and then obviously the liquidity is incredible and all the value that's going to be created from that. How much time have you spent at Templum to date thinking, now that we're actually digitizing securities, now that, you know, you put smart contracts on top of securities, and basically securities can become anything? Right, only limited by our imagination. You know, have you guys been thinking about kind of new innovations of what securities can be now that they're going to be digitized?
Well, not that we're focused exclusively on patents, but we have patents pending on smart contract construction that has 29 claims. Not really to set a standard. Right? When you begin to think that a security instrument just isn't equity or just as a debt, well, what if you can configure these new instruments around what a fan base or a consumer base in a particular organization would really resonate with them. Profit participation, revenue participation, dividending, baking in some level of a reward based in there as an incentive. So it becomes really, really vast, new territory. And then if you globalize, we took in a wonderful investment from SBI Holdings in Japan. We have a big focus on Asia itself as our next rollout. So it's, you know, the momentum as we're focused this conversation on the US, but it is truly a globalized movement towards security tokens.
And what do you guys think about in terms of kind of the innovation and what a security can be?
I agree that one of the main kind of detractors from the utility tokens is basically what it can't be, because now you're starting to bump up against security law. And with securities tokens, that's by definition already resolved. You're already within regulatory compliance. So then it switches over not so much what the underlying laws are, but it's a function of what the technology will allow. So that goes into what Vince was saying with regards to development of more complex smart contracts. And the other side of that is what the market is willing to buy. I mean, I think if you wind up getting too complex, it may scare away some of the investor base. But you know, I think it's the function of then at that point the technology and the underlying the buy side of the equation.
So you know, we want to leave, as I said, plenty of time at the end for networking from the great group here. But before we do that, let's take a few questions from the audience if anybody has a question. Yeah.
So Vince, you mentioned you talk about dark pools a little bit, the work in the industry and finance in general. Can you elaborate more? Do you see any correlation between dark pools and equities, between microstructure, and how crypto could become a dark pool, or is it competing with it? What's your thoughts on that?
Well, I can tell you what our thoughts are.
Yeah.
As Templum. So, again, going back to the core thesis of modernization of securities law. How do you take some components of existing securities law and modernize them for today? And that was really what we did around the alternative trading system, going back to 1998 when that was issued by the SEC. It really mandated all crossing networks to become an exchange for alternative trading system. And that was back to the days of ARCA, Island Internet, and see how that disrupted our public markets. Those were dark pools. You didn't see the activity, right? You routed your order into effectively a dark box, and it was executed. So in our petition, we asked, as there was a line in that original issue released in 1998 that said, our work on unregistered securities is not yet done. Right? In 2015, we went back to the SEC and said, well, it's almost 20 years, I think you have to get back to this. So we flipped the model to say, this is about transparency, and if you believe in transparency and you believe in what blockchain represents, it's about being lit, as we would say. So now you have displays of bids, offers, full depths of markets, you can put in indications of interest, and you're doing that in a transparent way versus not seeing what the activity is. So that's where we say the transition for us is about making it a lit or modern day ATS.
Okay, I have a question, Vince, probably. You've got institutions like Pantera Capital, let's pick that one as in, for instance, you've got hundreds of millions in your ICO funds of startups that they did SAFs with, and that they all are classified as utilities, every single one of them. And obviously they got a problem now, they step up to it, which is they're not, they're securities. What are these institutions going to do, realistically, given that they've now got this recent SEC clarity on what is and is not?
I'm gonna give you $20 for that question.
What are they gonna do?
So,
thank you for
noticing. Yeah. Well, it's a significant problem, I think. My partner, Chris Pallotta, and I went to Chair Clayton's office right after the issuance of the Dow report and said, we think there's an unintended consequence here that may not have seen. So if we pause it for a moment and say, as Chair Clayton would say, he hasn't seen an ICO that doesn't meet the hallmark of a security, and we frame that, there's been hundreds, if not thousands, of ICOs that are done that don't comply. Well, what happens, we've seen this with many, I won't say exchanges, crypto trading platforms that had to delist these instruments, right? They couldn't trade them anymore, because once you recognize that they're a security, if you're an unlicensed platform trading crypto, you can't trade a security. So guess what happens? You get delisted. So what we pointed out is we call those the orphan issuances. as an alternative trading system empowered to create secondary liquidity, we can't offer secondary liquidity because they were not issued properly. So that led to yet another petition that we filed with the SEC called the remediation program. And that was to really have the hallmark of investor protection to say, all of these investors are unduly trapped and they need to be able to have a pathway to at least have a chance at liquidity. So this very simply said, if there's no bad actors, there's been no fraud in the issuance, issuer hold your hand up and offer a right of rescission. And in doing that right of rescission, whether 50% of the people accepted none of it or a greater group, then we could repackage that offering in a proper security framework and those existing investors can have liquidity on our alternative trading system.
Sounds like you're both trying to comply with regulatory bodies. What do you think about New York State's bid license and Treasury's money transmitter rules?
I can't talk too much with regards to the details of the underlying licenses. I know, let's say, like the New York State bid license law has really, I think the real effect of that is pushing a lot of the blockchain community out of New York to go elsewhere. I mean, I think a lot of this overall has pushed a lot of potential issuers overseas in general. But I mean, there's a lot of real quality companies out there within the blockchain enabled space that you can't even go to their website if you're using a New York IP address. So I think there was, this was the law of unintended consequences, and so I haven't seen a lot of other states run out to really replicate what that did. I don't know if you want to go a little bit more into depth on the ATS front.
Sure, well, we don't transact or touch crypto, so we're not a money transmitter or self-clearing, so there's not a requirement for us. Although it's a particular challenge, I believe as most people look at how New York State Department of Finance had instituted that, and it has had the effect of a bit of a chill on New York State. In many of the states, I think there's 23 states in the U.S., if you are a registered broker-dealer, as we are in those states, you do get a grandfathering in for money transmitter should we need it, but we don't have a plan anytime soon to become a money transmitter.
Can we talk about exchanges? So what do you have an opinion of the regulated exchanges, i.e. the New York Stock Exchange, the NASDAQ, and Coinbase or whatever, where are moving towards more regulated securities exchanges and what then we might be able to do on them in, say, T plus a year? I know it's hypothetical.
I'm
going to
get angular, but I have an opinion on everything. But I certainly wouldn't classify Coinbase as an exchange, and I think that's part of the challenge, or a securities exchange, right? And again, if you had asked Chair Clayton in the issuing release of March of last year, he put forth that all crypto platforms should be an exchange and alternative trading system. So Coinbase is not yet, and hence I think their attempt at buying Keystone, and I think it's a great sign of the writing on the wall of greater regulatory conformity. Listen, I think New York, NASDAQ, and other true exchanges are going to move to this space. Like, why is this particular space so attractive? Because there's margins, right? There's volatility, all the hallmarks of what exchanges had made their money on, right? They love volatility. They going back before we decimalization, right? We traded quarters, halves, or whatever it may be, so represents new opportunities to have those, and it also represents data, right? The trading flows, where do the exchanges make so much money, is on their feeds. So I think we will see a migration of the big exchanges entering the space, whether acquisition or starting up new divisions.
Yeah, and they'll wait to jump in the pool. I mean, a lot of the big institutions that I've spoken with, They may not be going out there digitalizing assets or things like that, but they've been making investments into, let's say, proprietary trading platforms and other things to kind of capitalize on that volatility. So they're kind of going up that evolutionary curve.
Okay, Okay, we'll take one more. Go. My head hurts. recently, with regard to internet advertising and privacy, there's been something that's happened in Europe, which is causing everyone here that has a website to re-ask you permission to, we can do this with your data. And assuming that most of the customers with extra cash are either in Europe or the Middle East or in Asia, and assuming that the people that are in, you know, the transfer agents and the exchanges are not going to be leaders, if a you have a customer that adapts, then who's an alpha, then everybody else will adapt, right? But now I'm getting back to the point where you've got the SEC and everybody else that's going to go, you know, step on you. Do you have anything that how this whole thing can play out?
I was with you up until so there's lots of ways that it plays out, but I think the hallmark to all regulated entities is the protection of client information. So what is happening in Europe and forcing different levels of disclosure and compliance here to notification of clients of what happens with their data, how it's protected, it's not the worst thing in the world. Those jurisdictions that you reference where there may be lots of liquidity, for us, doesn't matter. They still have to come in and conform to AML, OFAC, World Check backgrounds, and if they're passing those tests and they have a money center bank in which they're transferring from, they're okay to become a client, and we'll preserve their data and make all the necessary disclosures.
And I would just like to say, kind of like at a macro level, I think you're saying like kind of who pulls who. I mean, as I said earlier, obviously, you know, because we're talking security tokens, this is already something that, you know, in theory, the SEC and the regulators are already in tune with. But there's also the issue of what's different now. It's something, the phenomenon we see in other stages, right, where we see, let's say, Uber and the New York City Tax and Limousine Commission, or Airbnb and all these things. So it's almost like where the regulators themselves, when there's so much push, there's so much demand from the public. When Korea came in and started regulating the exchanges, and where it's even more hyper of a market over there, it was, you know, the public outcry was so large that it almost kind of pulled the regulators into, you know, coming up with a solution that was more amicable to the growth in the space. And so I think you make it a demand-driven move as well. So as long as these, I think the biggest thing with regards to amicable regulation was for a lot of these people that are doing these underlying projects to really build out what they're doing, make them useful to the general population, and really like make that dream a reality. Because if a lot of these things wind up busting and people losing a lot of money, and there's all kinds of frauds and things like that, that gives far more credence to the regulators than actually, you know, solving the world's problems.
Okay, let's give Tim and Vince a big hand. Thanks, guys.